The 3DO Interactive Multiplayer, the ambitious at one time next generation console that had a unique business model which 3DO company founder Trip Hawkins had intended to implement to take over the world of console gaming. The hardware that had been developed by Dave Needle and RJ Mickle of the New Technologies Group was unique in that it would be licensed to third parties so that anyone could manufacture 3DO consoles. The cutting-edge technology would never fully take off due to a range of business blunders related to 3DO consoles' high price points, paired with an underwhelming library of games and an oversaturated console market that would become even more competitive the moment the Sony PlayStation and Sega Saturn hit the marketplace. With the 3DO not reaching its full potential, it was back to the drawing board to create even more powerful hardware in a race to release the world's most powerful game console. Today, we shall cover this interesting chapter in gaming history. I'm Lady Decade, and this is the story of the Panasonic M2, the sequel to the 3DO Interactive Multiplayer. In the mid-90s, it became very apparent very quickly that the once promising 3DO had become a dead duck. Like in any scenario like this, it would lead people behind the project scrambling to come up with a solution to reverse their fate. So Needle and Mickle would go back to doing what they do best, and that would be to come up with new and improved 3DO hardware. The first thing that would be announced with regards to this was that the pair were developing an add-on chip for the original 3DO in the form of a custom PowerPC microprocessor. However, the plan would become more ambitious as time progressed, with further news breaking at the 1995 Electronic Entertainment Expo. Here it would be announced that 3DO were also developing a brand new standalone system known as the M2, with a prototype of this device appearing at this event and being demonstrated. For further clarification, they would mention that the add-on chip for the original model would still be made available in the future too, giving existing 3DO owners hope that they had not just flushed all their hard-earned money down the toilet. Plans for this project, distribution-wise, would remain the same as what the 3DO company had already been doing previously. Thus meaning that multiple manufacturers would be intended to build M2s, such as Panasonic and Goldstar, for example. This would all soon change though when news would break that the 3DO company had been sold to Panasonic, giving them the exclusive rights to manufacture every M2 model themselves, meaning the M2 would have been distributed in a much more traditional manner than the previous 3DO system. Reportedly, this acquisition would send many would-be M2 developers into a panic, instantly feeling that there would perhaps be a smaller install base of M2 owners than even the 3DO Interactive Multiplayer previously, reconsidering whether it was worth them learning to develop games for M2 hardware in the first place. Shortly after the Panasonic acquisition, it is also of note that this Japanese company began discussing a partnership with Sega, with the potential of making the M2 the sequel to the Sega Saturn, which is not surprising at all really when we look at the amount of almosts that have been happening when it comes to Sega over the years. Talks would fall apart though through mid-1996, even though according to the 3DO president himself, Trip Hawkins, the deal between these Japanese Goliaths was virtually finished and only fell apart at the very last minute. So thus far we have spoken a lot about who owned the M2 and when, but what exactly was this mysterious device? Well, according to a 3DO spokesman known as Omid Kordestani, the M2 could generate 1 million polygons per second with the graphics features turned off, and 700,000 polygons per second with the features turned on. In fact, there were even plans at one stage to allow the M2 to feature a built-in DVD player, which would have beaten the PlayStation 2 to the market for several years, a feature that many people credit today as one of the PS2's greatest aids in winning the console wars. So, it's interesting to see if people would have been so interested in the same feature if it had been included with the M2 years earlier. According to 3DO Senior Vice President of Hardware Engineering Toby Ferrand, he backs up these claims even further by stating that the M2 was designed knowing that we could make it a DVD-capable player. A super powerful system being announced in the mid-90s that could also play DVDs would obviously send gaming journalists into a complete frenzy. An example of this comes from Next Generation, who would give the system 4 out of 5 stars despite the fact that it had not been released yet, nor ever would be. They would hype up that the M2 was several times as powerful as any game console on the market, and would rave about the 3DO company's strategies that had been used to secure third-party developers for the system, drawing a conclusion that M2 had crossed the line from being a collection of fanciful tech specs to hard silicon that people can work on and believe in. By the 1996 Electronic Entertainment Expo, 1 year removed from the system's previous demo, attendees and people who followed the event would notice that things were amiss, as the M2 would not even make an appearance that year. Instead, a spokesperson from Panasonic would be present at the show, who would inform those who were looking to learn more about the product that they were not entirely sure anymore how they wanted to use M2 tech, or even if they wanted to manufacture their own game console anymore, full stop. Moving on to the tail end of 96, a release date had still not been published for the M2, even though the system's secured third-party publishers had continued to boast that the M2 was significantly more powerful than the Nintendo 64, a platform at the time that was of course being marketed as the world's most powerful game console. EGM would report on the M2 around this time, summarising that, "Some months, it seems the boat is still afloat. Rumours crop up of a public showing, new demos come out, or a Matsushita official doles out some tantalising hints. Other months, it seems the boat has capsized, with developers scrambling to get off the boat whilst they still can." All of this, I guess, emphasised further that no one really had a clue for sure where this was all going, as the information about M2 that was being presented was often inconsistent from source to source. After this point, years of hype and speculation surrounding the M2, by mid-1997, the M2 video game console would finally be cancelled for good. The reasoning given behind this by Panasonic is that they felt it would be futile trying to compete against the likes of the Nintendo 64 and Sony PlayStation due to how high quality the top-selling games on each device were, and they felt they lacked the experience necessary to be able to become a legitimate competition at this point. What makes all of this particularly interesting, though, is that the M2 was cancelled at such a late stage that the marketing of the console was already taking place, with flyers already existing and being distributed advertising the hardware. These flyers would even show off prospective launch titles and featured gameplay screenshots of cancelled M2 games. Speaking of games, as early as 1995, games in development had previously been shown to the general public, which would include the likes of Clay Fighters 3, Descent and Iron Blood, which would turn up as Iron and Blood on the Sony PlayStation. There was also D2, a sequel to, well, D, and Studio 3DO claimed they were working on a version of Battle Sports for the M2. There are, in fact, lots of other games too that are confirmed to have gone into M2 development, and it is also of note that both Capcom and Konami, major game developers at the time, would have both supported M2 hardware. Actually, according to the publication known as Ultra Games, there was a period where 80 M2 games were all in development simultaneously. As for the death of the M2 in the world of gaming, Trip Hawkins commented, "The M2 was a very powerful 64-bit design with a lot of RAM and a big disk drive. Perhaps, like the 3DO, it was slightly ahead of its time because of the component costs. But this is the design direction where the industry is headed." Speaking of Trip, when the 3DO company sold exclusive rights to its M2 to Panasonic, they would be paid $100 million. This meant that in the first quarter for 1996, the 3DO company turned a profit for the first time since it was founded, with a net income of $1.2 million, thus meaning 3DO themselves would benefit massively from the M2, despite the console never seeing a release. When it comes to Panasonic and the M2 though, rather than wasting the technology they had paid $100 million for completely, they would opt to bizarrely use the tech within automated teller machines, and in Japan, in coffee vending machines. From the year 2000 onwards, it would also be used in the interactive kiosk market. Furtherly, PlanetWeb Incorporated began offering software to allow the M2 to be used as an internet appliance, meaning none of these efforts were completely abandoned, just none of it panned out as excitingly as we would have hoped. Being a gaming channel though, we are of course most interested in the cancelled M2 game console, which fortunately still has a little bit more history we are yet to touch on. This includes that development kits and prototypes of the machine have become very valuable pieces over time and can now be found in the hands of lucky collectors. Perhaps the closest thing that saw official releases that came closest to game consoles would be the interactive media players created around 1998. According to VideoGameConsoleLibrary.com, these include the M2FZ21S and the M2FZ35S. Both products were aimed at professionals working in medicine, architecture, and sales rather than the home market. The FZ21S was more sleek and compact, whereas the FZ35S is the more high-end model that featured a DVD-ROM drive for increased content storage capabilities and more. In the exciting world that is the modern internet, occasionally still new stuff surfaces with relation to the M2. For example, in 2010, IMSA Racing was made available to the public, which was a completely finished M2 game. In 2020, the YouTube channel Video Game Esoterica showed off a compilation demo disc containing 12 diverse demos of various titles that were in development for the cancelled M2 gaming platform. So perhaps in the future there will be even more M2 stuff to come. But for now, I am Lady Decade, and that was the story of the Panasonic M2, the sequel to the 3DO interactive multiplayer. If you've enjoyed today's tale looking at yet another piece of unreleased gaming hardware, then please be sure to leave your thoughts on today's content in the comments section down below. If you are new here and want to see more videos like this, be sure to check out my backlog, hit that subscriber button, and ring that damn notification bell as I upload 2 videos like this each and every week. Before I close today's video completely, I would, as always, like to give a quick thank you to this channel's patrons who are helping me push this channel forward with the momentum at a level I never felt possible. So huge thank yous go to the following people for their generosity when it comes to building this channel. Shoutouts go to Sebastian Velez, House of the Ted, Christopher DiViejo, Scott Healy, Dendritti, William J. Scott III, Richard Turnbull, Beyond Many, Johnny Holly, Venthros, Jesus Gonzalez, Irk the Irk, OPC, EmuMovies.com, PWND Games, Consoles, Accessories, John McCormick, Corey Udekirk, Mr. Vestek, Joshua Collard, Ben Harradine, Gasper Heller, Instant Gratification Monkey, Green Cooper, Sedgemeister, and Ego, as well as all of the rest of my lovely patrons. Thank you all so very much. Thank you. Bye!